So I'm going to have a slightly different talk track for my tech tips this week. I'm going to be talking about the unique architecture that a lot of people aren't aware of, that the Aircomp Vision cameras have, that's really distinguishing us from the rest of the industry. We have a unique electronic design for our cameras, and that includes the use of a field programmable gate array, an FPGA. And that's what we actually use for feature video processing on our cameras, and it distinguishes us from competing solutions. So the FPGA allows our cameras to be upgraded in the field. Brad mentioned that earlier. And as new features and technology are developed, it actually allows you to do some sort of future-proofing by adding new features and core technologies after the fact, once the camera has been purchased and installed. The big difference with an FPGA versus a lot of competitors is it's not a hard-coded device. For instance, an ASIC is a common integrated circuit, an application-specific integrated circuit technology that's either purchased off the shelf or built to order by a lot of other manufacturers. In the case of that type of technology, the entire product is designed and then hard burned onto the chip. An FPGA is not like that. We can change the core programming at will by use of firmware. So that allows us to implement changes and improvements at a much deeper hardware level than a lot of competitors. Hard-coded devices just offer a lot less flexibility in upgrade to new features and technologies. Another thing that's unique about us, we own our code from the bottom up. We have our proprietary firmware. You might hear that referred to as the bare metal code. That's developed and exclusive to Aircomp Vision. We own it from the FPGA processing up to the firmware and the UI. That's completely Aircomp Vision. It means there's no outside licensing involved. It means we are not an off-the-shelf commercial operating system or something like Linux or Artos. And it allows us a rapid development product cycle for new features and new camera designs. We can very efficiently roll or leverage existing designs into new products. So that has a lot of advantage for you. With the firmware features can be upgraded. Now, that means on average, once a year, we're going to be releasing updates. Those are going to be adding improvements, new features. Brad, for instance, mentioned SnapStream. That's one thing we can retroactively, that's your future-proofing, we can add a new technology, a core compression technology to existing cameras in the field and add even more improvement to a product that's already been out there. We can add feature improvements. We can add fixes. In the case of compatibility, there are some BMSs, not the core ones, but some BMSs do require a specific firmware version. You can actually downgrade the firmware as well if that's necessary for compatibility, or if your VMS is suggesting using the latest, which is typically our recommendation, you can upgrade it in the field. Now that's actually available on our website, so you can go and download that. And I'll talk about that in a little bit. Talking again about ASIC technology, as I said, hard-coded solutions have some limitations. Typically, when someone is a manufacturer buying one of these ASIC type devices, the existing feature sets are part of the design they're purchasing or part of the design that they're building. And they're often purchased from third-party vendors off the shelf. So that means essentially, what you buy is what you get. Any additional development is pretty limited. Adding new features and improvements is often not possible or very limited. Also, in terms of the operating system that runs those ICs, that can come with additional license fees, and that may add hidden costs to the product you're not aware of, taking out of the margin. You're also potentially inheriting any existing vulnerabilities that come with that operating system in that product, and I'll talk about that in a moment, which is cybersecurity. A lot of you may or may not be aware, There have been some high-profile denial-of-service attacks taken lately on internet infrastructure. And these devices that were used were actually security devices, basically Internet of Thing devices. And there's been a lot of talk in our industry about security as a result of those attacks. In those attacks, basically, the devices that were used were cameras. And existing backdoors in the off-the-shelf operating systems were used. And hackers basically used those backdoors to turn those devices into little robot slaves and use them to attack internet infrastructure. That is something that will not happen with Aircon Vision. And that is because we don't use Linux or RTOS or any other off-the-shelf operating system. So that firmware code I just talked about that we own from the bottom up, it doesn't inherit any of the known vulnerabilities that come with these off-the-shelf operating systems. These are ones that hackers commonly exploit because they're well known. Basically, it means that owning our protocol implementation means that zombification type attacks using Telnet or other backdoors, they're just not possible with our products. The vulnerability was never there in the first place to allow you to compromise our devices. So that's a reassuring fact about owning that and sort of another added benefit to having this technology. So I mentioned the firmware updates are available on our website. And under the top menu on our website, you can either go under support menu and select firmware downloads directly, or you can go to the resource center and you will see firmware downloads over on the left side menu as well. Typically, we post recent firmware update along with several previous versions. So if you do need to download older version for a compatibility reason, that usually is available, so you can go forward or backwards as needed. Also linked on that page, you will see a link for the AVIP utility. The AVIP utility is basically our software that you can use to do bulk upgrades for multiple cameras on the site. You can find it either through the link on the firmware download page, or the same way, support and software downloads, or from the resource center and software downloads on the left side of the menu. You'll basically just browse for the firmware, find the model that you've got, and then look at the firmware versions that are available. In the case, and this is very rare, that a hardware file is required, first I'll explain. A hardware file is simply a lower level type of firmware. It is sort of like the BIOS on a PC. It is not very common. Once every couple years when we change platforms do we change the hardware file. There are some older products, though, in order to get the latest firmware, you might need that. If while you're browsing for your product on that page, you find that hardware file, you'll be receiving a notification that you should contact the Technical Assistance Center. That's the support center. When you do, we can provide that file. Usually there's specific instructions, a certain order that needs to be followed in order to apply the hardware and then apply the firmware. So that's not very common, but if you have an older product, you may see that type of note. That's pretty straightforward. Just ask us for it, and we will provide that hardware and the instructions. So that's just to make sure there's no unintended consequences with the hardware update. Firmware, you really don't need Technical Assistance Center. It's a pretty straightforward process I will describe. Moving on. Going to give you a few tips regarding firmware if you decide this is something needed. Now, if everything works and you're happy with your system, there's no need to go through the firmware update. If you want to add a new feature or technology, like we were discussing, SnapStream or other ones, or there is a known improvement, a fix, or a compatibility with a given firmware, then you would have reason to do that upgrade. So some tips regarding that. The obvious one is go find the firmware on our website, or if there's a hardware file, contact the Technical Assistance Center, get the hardware and the firmware file together. At that point, the cameras really are designed to put the precedence on streaming live video. That's their primary task. So if you have any open streams in a BMS, or someone is viewing the camera somewhere else, either via the web page or otherwise, you'll want to stop those open stream requests, because that can interfere with the firmware update process. The camera's going to be more focused on outputting video versus doing an update. Once you've stopped any of those streams, you have two methods you can access the camera to update the firmware. Either use the IP utility, discover the camera, and do a bulk upgrade. You can also update cameras one at a time if you want in the IP utility. Or go into the camera webpage and access the camera that way, and either go to the admin or system menu, you will see an option for firmware update. At that point, whether you're using the IP utility or the webpage, you're going to browse to the update file location and select it. Then the update's going to start. That usually takes just a few seconds, not too long. The one major tip I have for you is during that process, hopefully you won't, but do not power cycle the cameras during that process. There is a point while you are doing the firmware update that it is basically going to be overriding the operating system. Now, it's hard to do, but if you had the power go out at the exact time that it is doing that, that could create an issue. So, you know, one, stop the streams, and two, make sure you don't turn the camera off after you start the update until it's complete. Once the update is complete, you can confirm it was successful either by looking at the firmware version, which will be displayed and changed in the IP utility, or in the upper right-hand corner of the camera webpage, it also displays the firmware version. Once you're sure it was successful, any custom settings you have, you can use the IP utility to save those and reapply after the update. Or if you did it in the webpage, you might go back in and make those custom changes and save them to flash on the camera. Once you've done that, resume your video streaming, and you're done. It's actually a pretty straightforward and simple process. So with that, I'm going to hand it back to Jeff for the Code Blue.
All right, thank you, Ted. So another thing to remember, one of the slides that we had in Ted's presentation that you saw, there was an image of a field update on cybersecurity that we released on November 21st. That one talks about some of those incidents that Ted was mentioning where surveillance cameras, DVRs, appliances, lots of things were taken over to do major denial of service attacks on the internet. And you know, lots have been made about needing passwords and things like that. AirCon Vision cameras ship with a 16-digit ASCII password. But we do have limitations on what we force the end user customer to use, because it's a matter of how easy is the camera for the end user to use, how complicated is it, etc. So we provide a password. If somebody was to get that password and break into the camera, all they're really able to do is impact that camera. They can see they can make setting changes from the camera web page. They could see some of the video from it. But unlike every other camera that we know of, because of the FPGA architecture, they are not able to move on and use that as a bot to attack other devices on the internet, get to other cameras, etc. So it's a very unique capability that we have built into the FPGA, and you'll be seeing much more about it. If you haven't seen that field update from November 21, talk to your AirCon Vision regional sales team, and they'll be able to provide you with a copy of it, because it has links to a number of articles on the topic.